Pakistan's biggest problems is poverty, which affects a third of its population. Despite international efforts to remove children from the workforce, an estimated 3.6 million of them continue to work, and that number may be even higher. Children in a variety of industries work long hours under hazardous conditions for almost nothing. NPR's Ann Garrels reports.
Producing bricks is a family business. Parents and children dig the earth, shape the bricks, bake them in the sun, and then transport them to a kiln in a horse-drawn cart. It takes a day to make 1,000 bricks, for which the entire family earns a little over $1. The families are in debt to the owners, the children little more than bonded slaves. Families can't afford to lose their children's income altogether, but Hans Lococo of the International Labor Organization says a new program is offering a break for some of these kids.
We take them out from their work for 5 to 6 hours. So we reduce their working hours. 5, 6 hours they will spend at school. And then after that they can go back again and work at home. So partially withdrawal.
Vikran doesn't know how old he is, but he's somewhere about 11. He works from 7 in the morning until 2:30, when, under this new program, he now attends an informal school. The first time he's ever had any education.
He said that the teacher has taught him English, Urdu, and
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
His younger sister Yasmina scoops up mud, pats it into a form, and deftly turns out brick after brick. Her family can't spare her, so she doesn't go to school.
I want to read, I want to get out of this thing, and I want to be something.
In many Pakistani villages, there are no government schools at all. If there are state schools, the parents have to pay fees, which these families can't afford. Until recently, the only free schools were the madrasas, where poor children usually receive only religious training, and where they've been easy fodder for Islamic militants. These informal schools are an alternative. The hours are adapted to meet the kids' needs, and the children aged 7 to 14 are taught the basics. In 3 months, 11-year-old Sumera has learned to read. Her notebook is full of drawings. This is the first time she's ever had crayons. She loves school, though it's little more than a covered porch where the children sit on mats. The brick project is just beginning. Families have received no support from the owners. In the carpet industry, which employs about 125,000 children, 10,000 are now enrolled in these informal schools. Because this is an export industry, international pressure, with the threat that sales could be affected, pushed manufacturers to support the program. They've put up $1 million. The U.S. Department of Labor has added another $2 million. Khadam Hussein is a carpet weaver and a member of the education committee in the village of Verne here in central Pakistan. He can't read or write, but he wants his children to get an education. He says carpet contractors were initially reluctant to let the children off work, but the village eventually won out. The families are losing some money. Hussein says education is more important. It takes 2 months to weave a 4 by 6 foot carpet, for which the family will earn a total of $30. The children still sit at the loom several hours a day. Their tiny fingers fly as they tie knot after knot. 10-year-old Sonia started at the age of 3, handing her mother threads. Now she's able to weave the most complicated of designs. By the end of the day, though, she says her fingers hurt so much she can barely stand it. But once again, she says her family's so poor she has to help out. Once these kids learn the basics, Hans Lococo of the ILO hopes some can be moved into government schools. But ultimately, for this program to work, there has to be funding for school fees, for vocational training, and alternative, better-paying employment.
At this moment, ILO is helping, other NGOs, international NGOs are helping, but I think at the end, it is a national problem. The government should take it as a national problem, and they have to prepare and include adequate budget and the development plan so that they can support their own child labor elimination program.
The government has yet to target the most dangerous industries. Tens of thousands of children work in mines, tanneries, and the glass and textile factories. Ann Garrels, NPR News, Lahore.